meeting is now streaming live on Facebook.
I have streamed live.
So let him share the link, then we'll start. It's 10:58, so we'll start at 11:11.
बजे शुरू हुआ
तो तुम मार दो
क्या
तुम मार दो ना इस पे
भी नहीं नहीं कल आएगा तो कर कर
मैं पहुंच रहा हूं
वेरी गुड मॉर्निंग सर गुड मॉर्निंग ऑल ऑफ यू
गुड मॉर्निंग अपाला
मॉर्निंग
नहीं नहीं पहली बार ऐसे ये वाला कर रहे हैं ना तो थोड़ा सा अजीब नहीं लग रहा है
Facebook live will start now.
Yes, it is starting. Yeah. Ashutosh, have you sent the link? So we can start.
Is my screen shared, Vinita?
No, your screen sharing is not there, sir.
It's not there.
Ma'am,
now it's there.
You may start. I'm sending the yes.
Now it's there, sir.
Okay, thank you, Vinita.
So should we start now? Ashutosh?
Yep.
Ravinder, link you can send it to our webinar committee also members so that they can share it to other groups as well.
Ma'am, you may start. I have sent it to the committee.
Okay. Fine. So, sir, we are starting.
Sure. Good.
Good morning, everyone. I welcome you all to the webinar on higher education in India after COVID-19, organized under the aegis of Internal Quality Assurance Cell of Atmaram Snatan Dharma College. On behalf of the IQAC of ARSD College, I welcome our speaker, Professor Ram Ramaswamy, visiting professor in the Department of IIT Delhi. We are really honored to have you with us, sir. And we are grateful that you took out time, your valuable time for us. Now I invite the principal of our college, Dr. Gyantosh Kumar Jha, who has always been a guiding force and motivation behind all webinars which we have organized and will be held in the coming days, to welcome Professor Ram Ramaswamy.
Thank you, Vinita. Good morning to all. On behalf of Atmaram Sanatan Dharma College, I welcome Professor Ram Ramaswamy. and all the participants who are attending this webinar. It is a great pleasure and honor for me to have you here, sir, and you became ready for delivering your lecture on a very relevant issue and topic, higher education in India after COVID-19. Sir, in fact, we are living in a very peculiar situation these days during the lockdown period and staying at home. And we, the academician and teachers, always think about what will be the future of the higher education after COVID-19. In fact, we have several questions in our mind in these days of uncertainty about the safe taking place after COVID-19 in the field of higher education, and what kind of challenges, what kind of questions we are going to face in future. So you became ready for this lecture and you gave your valuable time for this webinar. And I am grateful to you, I am thankful to you. And once again, I welcome you, sir. I congratulate my webinar team for organizing these kind of webinars, live sessions, discussions, debates since 1 month. And they are engaging us in a very beautiful manner and in a very insightful program. Thank you all. I welcome once again Professor Ram Ramaswamy. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir. Professor Ram Ramaswamy did BSc Chemistry from Loyola College, Madras, MSc Chemistry from IIT Kanpur, and then PhD in Chemistry from Princeton University on the topic Energy Transfer Processes in Molecular Systems, vision of H.A. Rabbits. His postdoctoral advisor, Professor Rudolph A. Marcus, went on to win the Nobel Prize at California Institute of Technology. Professor Ramaswamy has about 200 journal publications and book articles related to chemical dynamics, classical and quantum chaos, semi-classical quantization, disordered systems, and statistical physics. Students have been awarded PhD degree and 3 are currently doing PhD under his supervision. Some of the prominent positions held by Professor Ramaswamy are presently, he is visiting professor, Department of Chemistry, IIT Delhi. He was a professor at School of Physical Sciences from 1990 to 2018 and professor for Center for Computational Biology and Bioinformatics from 2002 to 2018 at Jawaharlal Nehru University. He was Vice Chancellor of University of Hyderabad from June 2011 to January 2015. He was the Chairman of National Council of Rural Institutes Hyderabad from 2012 to 2015. He was the Vice President and Editor of Publications, Indian Academy of Sciences, Bangalore, 2013-15. These are a few of his assignments, and there are many more and many awards he has won. So, but don't waste time because we want to interact with him and hear him speak. Sir, I invite you to deliver your talk on the topic Higher Education in India After COVID-19.
Thank you very much, Vinita. Thank you, Professor Jha. It's a pleasure to be at this webinar. As it happens, your college, ARSD, is one that I have not visited in person, even though I've been, passed by y'all many times. So this is a strange way to make your acquaintance for the first time. Nevertheless, I'm happy to be here with you. I'm going to talk today about higher education in India post-COVID-19. And this is a very personal view. I'm aware that we are living through a very changing time. So it's not as if anyone has all the answers. Things could change very drastically today, tomorrow, anytime soon. Nevertheless, I believe that there are some things that we have learned in the last 1.5, 2 months of isolation, lockdown, And I believe that, you know, as teachers and as students, this is a matter on which we should not only be interested, we should have an opinion, because we can't just wait to react to what a government tells us. We have a higher responsibility that we all share. So the subtitle of my talk really is how the pandemic could be changing the rules of the game. And let me tell you what the talk will be roughly like. It's largely based on a blog post of mine, and the address to the blog is given out there. It's myname.wordpress. So in this talk, what I try to do is to briefly tell, you know, give some background about the pandemic, the biology, the medicine, what have you, and then come to the main part of it, which is when does post-COVID start? This is not a straight cut matter. What the implications for higher education, and by higher education, I really mean tertiary education or college and above. What are the changes that we are already seeing in classrooms? And what are the changes we are going to see in teachers? What are the expectations that we have of the system? A matter that concerns me a lot, and I'm sure it concerns many of the teachers and others in this room, is what are the implications for research in the country? And what are the opportunities for change? Okay, so let me start by, you know, the standard picture. This is the coronavirus image, which all of us have seen. We probably see one every day in one form or the other. Now, coronaviruses are so called because of their appearance. They have a halo-like structure, and the Latin word for a crown is corona. They were first actually identified by this lady here, June Almeida, in 1964. She was a spectroscopist, a virologist, and she saw these images for the first time and noted that there was a fringe of projections which give this virus its name. Because it recalls the solar corona. There are several kinds of coronaviruses that are known, and seven of them seem to affect humans. But this one that we are talking about, SARS-CoV-2, it's a so-called beta coronavirus, and it seems to have been first seen in Wuhan in China late last year. It's zoonotic. This is again a word that all of us have learned very quickly over the last few months. It's transmitted from animals to humans. And in this particular case, it's very likely to have come from bats. The main thing that the virus does once it infects the human is that it causes respiratory and gastrointestinal tract infections. In 1968 was the first occurrence of the term in the scientific literature. Here is an image of the little note that June Almeida sent along with her colleagues where the word coronavirus is mentioned. Now, the reason why it's just caught us all completely by surprise is that the disease is highly contagious. It was reported by China at the end of last year, and already in 2.5 months, the WHO declared it to be a pandemic. The number of cases increases extremely rapidly. There is essentially no country that has been spared. And we've seen all these facts, but I mean, the implications for us are a consequence of some of these facts. The high level of contagiousness is what makes us all scared. And these are numbers that actually come from today. So almost 4 million cases have been observed all over the world, and the number of deaths is very, very large. In India, we've crossed 50,000 and the number of deaths is almost 2,000. There is reason to worry about these numbers, about what the numbers are and what they actually mean and so on. But let me tell you, talk about what are the issues as far as we are concerned. I mean, everything concerns us, of course, but particularly at this time, there is no vaccine for the disease. Some drugs are showing promise, but these are really very early days, and it will be at least 6 months to a year before anything can be reliably administered. The case fatality rate, which is the number of deaths per 100 cases, is around 4%. But this doesn't always tell the picture, because people are unwell, people need a lot of hospitalization. And one of the worst things about this disease is that the asymptomatic cases, namely people who don't appear to have the disease but are nevertheless transmitting it, these numbers are really much in excess of the numbers that we are detecting. It could be even a factor of 2. As of now, the only protection we have against this particular disease is somehow to avoid it. So we isolate. That's why we are all in lockdown. We are told elementary hygiene, wash your hands, wash with soap, don't touch your face, wear a face mask, don't meet too many people, hold your seminars on the internet so that you don't have to come in contact with anybody. This is the only thing that we know of protecting ourselves right now. Frequent testing, quarantining those who test positive, keeping a list of the contacts and continuing to trace them. This is, these are the protocols. And in the absence of a cure, testing and early detection seems to be the only way of protecting ourselves. And in this regard, actually, India is not too terribly bad. We have tested over a million samples have been tested using modern molecular biology for detection of this virus, and about 50,000 cases have been detected. Today, the capability is to do 75,000 tests, but the availability of the testing equipment, all these are issues for us. Countries that are really much better than us also tend to be somewhat smaller, much smaller, and much better off. For now, we are testing mostly at-risk individuals, namely those who seem to have the flu, those who have contacts with COVID-19 people, positive people, and healthcare professionals. But really what's necessary is to do random testing in the population, and then we will be a little more secure about this disease. Now, we must remember that this is not the first pandemic, and this is not the is not going to be the last either. In about 100 years ago, the Spanish flu, which actually originated in the US, but it swept the entire world, and it claimed anywhere between 17 to 50 million lives. Okay, that's, I mean, this SARS-CoV-2 has not even reached a million. But in India alone, 100 years ago, 12 million people seem to have died. At that time, the average life expectancy was under 30 years. You can see it on this graph. Today, the average life expectancy in India is almost 70 years. Given the scale of the disease, which basically means that it's going to affect a lot more people, but not kill necessarily all these people, we really need to start preparing for this post-COVID-19 world. At present, actually, we have very few options. Given our ignorance of the disease, the inadequate public health support that we have in our country, there was actually no option here or anywhere else but we had to close down colleges and universities. The ever-increasing numbers of confirmed positive, it drives home the point that there was a good reason for us to be concerned. And what we did was, in fact, the right thing. No one is insulated from this virus by wealth or by privilege. You can't, you could run away to your private island if you like, but then you couldn't do anything over there. So this is not, this is a virus that hits everybody. And getting the disease is much a matter of chance. Treatment is difficult and mortality is, for diseases of this kind and contagious diseases, the mortality is high. And therefore, for now, what we know is wear masks, wash your hands, keep your distance, and keep repeating this through the day. Now, the statement, a saying that I like a lot, a ship in harbor is safe, but that's not what ships are for. We can continue to be in isolation, but humankind wasn't actually meant to just sit inside rooms and be scared. Sooner rather than later, there's going to be a vaccine. There will be drugs. There is a very promising drug from Gilead called Remdesivir. There is plasma therapy that has some hope. There are any number of companies across the world that have got potential vaccine candidates, and it's very likely that the vaccine will be made in India. And we have to address this because we can only take so much of isolation and prolonged physical distancing. We do need contact with people. We need to be up and about. We need to get back to normal life. But this is a term that we are all beginning to see more and more, that there is a new normal. And what is this new normal going to be in our case? Well, to start with, actually, when is post-COVID-19? When do we start? As all of us know, in India, the lockdown is ending in a way. That is, this is, instead of calling this lockdown 3.0, it is re-entry 1.0 or something like that. But we must remember that this disease is likely to be around for a long time. And most countries need to get back to work to revive economies. I mean, it's not possible for us. We'll become much, much less human. A very recent paper in Science estimates that the disease is likely to become a seasonal disease like the flu, recurring every so often, like the flu. And almost surely until 2022, if not 2024. So we are talking 5 years, 4 to 5 years, maybe a little more. There may be a vaccine coming up, but chances of the so-called herd immunity, where the entire population is immune to this disease by and large, and only some people get it, this is not going to be very high chances in the short term. By short term, now I mean 2 to 3 years, and the long term is, of course, much longer. And there's also another problem that, because of our obsession with COVID and everyone staying at home, many other diseases, non-communicable diseases that affect humans, have been neglected. There are instances of people who require cancer treatment, etc., who are not able to get to the hospitals or not able to get treatment, and so on and so forth. So there is a statement by a French philosopher that I'd just like to draw your attention to. He's talking specifically about this pandemic. So in a long interview somewhere, he says, "I have good news and bad news. The bad news is that we are all going to die. The good news is that the vast majority of us will die from something other than COVID-19. So let's have a little perspective about this disease, and let's worry about how to cope with COVID. Another thing that we are all seeing these days are these wonderful pictures of blue skies everywhere, and you know how nice you can see the Himalayas from Jalandhar or Saharanpur, or even from Chennai. I mean, some people are morphing pictures and putting stuff everywhere. But we must remember that this clear blue skies are, they're a consequence of the fact that really India has come to a halt. These are all very well, but they can't last if we are to come back to work. But hopefully we've learned how much we value clean environment, how much we value a certain amount of peace and quiet, and how we can do with much less than we keep wanting in this sort of constant material needs that we create for ourselves also help us to really spoil the environment in a way in which we should now be careful. So, what will higher education look like when the skies are not necessarily all that blue, but we are in a post-COVID mentality? Well, we're going to still have to wear masks. And I think one of the most wonderful things that we have learned from this particular disease, the way in which it has spread has been very rapid, but some 400 years earlier, John Donne wrote, "No man is an island entire of itself. Every man is a piece of the continent, a part of the main. If a clod be washed away by the sea, Europe is the less, as well as if a promontory were, as well as any manner of thy friends or of thine own were. Any man's death diminishes me because I am involved in mankind, and therefore never send to know for whom the bell tolls, it tolls for thee." Basically, John Donne has also lived through many plagues. He lived through catastrophes, and he was just pointing out that we are one humankind. There is no national boundaries over here, although there are small differences from country to country. This is a pandemic. It affects everybody in this world. Now to come to education, which is what really we want to talk about. I believe, and I've said this elsewhere, that education is a community activity. It's a communal activity. It is what a community does. Modern education, that is our schools, our college system, and so on and so forth, our main aim is to reach as many people as possible. We would really like to educate a large fraction, almost a third of the country in higher education. We'd like to educate everybody at the primary, almost everybody at the secondary, and at least 30 to 50% of the country at the tertiary level. We are really trying to reach many people. And the main reason we do this is that this is one of the few ways of reducing social inequalities. And we all know that a less unequal society is a better society. For education to be really effective, it thrives on discussion, on debate, on interaction, and all other means of social contact. Now, each subject has its own way of being taught, its own didactics, its own pedagogy. There are different ways of teaching different subjects. And, I'm trying to elaborate as to why I believe that this is a community or a communal activity. Each subject depends, or each teacher depends on other teachers. The quality of my class depends on how well a previous teacher has taught the same cohort. and how well I teach my students will affect how well later in time somebody else can teach them. Right? So different subjects are linked, teachers depend on other teachers, and the interaction between teachers and students is absolutely fundamental to the process of teaching. Notice how all these attributes of the classroom, of teaching, are an anathema to what we've been saying as to how to protect oneself from COVID and the pandemic. Now, even as I'm speaking, I realize that a seminar and a webinar are so different from one another. This is my first real time at giving a webinar. And I guess I miss not, I mean, I can see faces on a screen, some of them at least, but I miss this human interaction because this is so fundamental to the process of discussion, of debate, of interaction. And yet I know that we can't afford it. We can't afford it to do it for reasons of health. And since March of this year, many of you teachers and all students have shifted to this so-called online mode of instruction. Students are all in their homes today, as are all the teachers. We are all interacting with each other online. It's become a digital world. And this is our first introduction to the inequalities of the system, because not all students have equal access to the internet. And across the world, anything from 20 to 40% of any class is not able to attend in real time. And this is true of IITs where I'm sitting right now, and it is true of institutions all over the country. A recent article in Scroll, which Ashutosh pointed out to me, says that digital access across India is very patchy. We are very fortunate in Delhi, but only 8% of homes with students, that is between the ages of 5 to 24 years, have reliable computer and internet connections. The difference is very stark. Contrast between rural and urban households, homes where there are boys and homes where there are no boys, the investment of the family in the internet is very different. Economic disparities, of course, play a role, because if you can't afford it, you can't have it. And so under these circumstances, I believe that most teachers in India, and as a matter of fact, most teachers across the world, do not recommend online instruction. I know that many of us have been asked to do so, but we have been singularly unsuccessful in carrying the whole class. In the very near future, at least, purely online classes are not feasible for any institution. And this actually, I mean, as I said, different subjects require different kinds of teaching. So purely online classes are not going to be feasible. There's also a generation gap. The majority of teachers have not learned how to teach online. So, I mean, there are techniques. Not everybody can, everybody has to learn how to do this. One has to master the medium if you have to deliver the message, to abuse Marshall McLuhan. So there's an article in Inside Higher Education, it's over a year ago, and it's an indictment of online education, because across the world, people have noted that socioeconomic and racial achievement gaps are actually increasing as a consequence of online teaching. This is a US-centered magazine, and so one can translate racial to other kinds of groups in our country where achievement, you know, the kind of differences that we are trying to minimize, regrettably, we do not want to use methodologies that might actually accentuate those. Now today, as we are coming back to work, so to speak, these are the protocols that are being issued by Indian firms. Okay, and this is a long document from ITC, but I just wanted to point out a few things. In offices, remember, e-meetings are preferred, all with distancing and minimal people. Bring lunch from home, eat in your space, avoid going to other floors, wear masks, practice social distancing, at least 6 feet, etc. It gets a little tiresome, but no spitting, no coughing, don't walk around, don't share. Namaste is best. Okay, so they've got acronyms like MSSW and so on. This is nice. Can we have a socially distant classroom? Now, when countries or cities reopen, we are all going to be doing it with extreme caution. As a consequence of the lockdowns, this caution is getting hardwired into our systems. We are all automatically learning not to shake hands. We are all learning to keep a distance. We have to have our temperatures measured as soon as we go anywhere. So on the one hand, online classrooms are not preferred. The physical classroom is a necessity. But how do we have a classroom with both distancing measures as well as all the health protocols? We can have temperature sensors, we can have sanitizers and anything else you like, but with existing classroom sizes and class sizes, we cannot accommodate all students with this 2 meter separation. I don't know what this is going to mean, but perhaps we're going to have to split a class into smaller batches so that we can, but that means that teachers will have to repeat themselves. We may be forced to use some type of technology if we've got to ensure that not only do we have classes with students, but also help them to be healthy and safe under these circumstances. I know that all of us have opinions on this matter, and I hope that you all will raise them, but this is a matter of some concern because many of us are, in addition to being teachers, also parents of students. So we cannot propose measures for our class that we would be unhappy to see applied to our own children. And so these are some of these issues that we have to worry about. One way of at least trying to reduce some of this is to insist that we have fewer contact hours per course. See, right now the UGC has some mandated 44 lecture hours for a 3-credit course or some such thing like that. But for a long time, many of us have felt that this is just too much teaching. Do we need to teach quite so much? We've been talking about credit systems or credit-based choice, et cetera, et cetera. Let's take this seriously. Requiring students to spend 3, 4, 5 years physically in colleges and universities have to be replaced or may require to be replaced by a more practical requirement. Assessments will have to be more outcome-based learning. We have to change our methodologies. And this is the time when one misses an audience because I know that many teachers will be disagreeing instantly. The point is that you cannot have it both ways. You can't have all the safety that this disease requires. And as I said, this disease is going to be around with us for at least 4 to 5 years. But maybe there is a time for us to rethink some of the stuff that we've been doing unchanged for a long time. One aspect which I think will be very positive is that students will have to learn to learn on their own a little more. See, today's student has access to a wide range of material on the web, and many of them have already been using this. Khan Academy, Wikipedia, so on and so forth. People have been using this, but now this might become a primary source of learning. In the sciences and engineering, there is this wonderful resource at the IIT Madras, known as the NPTEL. This is available all over the world, actually. It's there for some technical subjects. These are complete courses of lectures in great depth. We may all have to help to increase the range and scope of these courses. In short, we're going to have to draw the student in into the process of learning much more than we have. It's much easier to come out and regurgitate something and then, you know, try to drum the subject into the student. But now I believe that really we have got to emphasize that learning is a shared responsibility, and much more has to be demanded of the student as preparation for courses and preparation for each class. You know, the flipped classroom is a model that has that many, many people have talked about, particularly in the West. But this is something that has to be experimented a lot more in all our institutions. And I feel that there'll be little option but to use this kind of innovation. Massive open online courses or MOOCs. The MHRD has been pushing these for a while. I had the experience of delivering a course last semester. I'm not entirely sure that it was all wonderful, but there may be no options left for us if students have got to be able to learn subjects without necessarily endangering their health. And particularly in institutions where infrastructure is deficient, which is true of many, many colleges and universities all over the country, if there are no faculty and we don't have resources, there may be no option but to not only take MOOCs, but also allow them for credit. And NPTEL has a model of these. All I'm saying is that we have to examine these things somewhat seriously. Now, teachers across the world, and not just in India, I mean, teachers across the world are going to have to relearn how to teach in these times. I think that this is going to require a lot of patience on the part of teachers, also on the part of students, as you see your teachers bungling through online and education in this new scenario. One of the skills that we are going to have to learn is also online teaching. Even if it's not completely replacing the classroom, it's going to have to be seen as augmenting the classroom. There's a very nice article in Nature recently where they talk about what are the do's and don'ts of online teaching. I'm not going to read this all out for you because some of it is just common sense, but it's to remember that, you know, finally you are teaching. You have to engage with students. You've got to get feedback from them online as you would if you were, you know, teaching in a regular class. And don't do everything as a video. I mean, today we have this classroom which is empty while the teacher is at the board, but in the future we may see some mixture of both these on and offline courses. I believe there's going to be a lot of pressure on us from the government, from higher education regulatory bodies like UGC, MHRD, etc. They've already endorsed this move to online education and online exams, but this is not a satisfactory solution from the point of view of teachers. And it needs a certain amount of intelligent resistance, at least until our institutions and our students find themselves to be ready for it. Particularly, public universities that cater to aspirations of all sections of society and students from those sections, many of who are from rural backgrounds, from economically less endowed groups. These have to be funded adequately to change the way in which they can teach and learn. To come to my theme that teaching is a communal or a community activity, the quality of one's instruction depends on how well students have been prepared. So cooperation is essential. Teachers should demand more cooperation from colleagues and to give more demands and to also place more demands on previous levels of instruction. There is a possibility that, you know, as we go down the line, better colleges, better teachers, better schools, better secondary schools. I know this is a little bit of a pipe dream, but really, if we realize that we've got no options, then this trickle down could happen. But beyond classrooms and teaching, there are some matters that are of concern. Because teachers and education is not just degrees and courses, it's also research. Faculties have to keep themselves engaged in research and seminars and so on. And we mentor PhD students. How do you do socially distant mentoring? And I believe that here the impact is going to be considerable because having taught at a university for 30 odd years and mentored a fair number of students, I know that this is an activity where close interaction between teachers and students is absolutely crucial. The stories of Ekalavya and all are all very well, but really proper mentoring requires a certain amount of interaction, which has been seriously retarded by a requirement of social distancing and so on and so forth. Informal interactions will become very difficult. And at least for some time, I know that we can't get back to this. At the same time, we've seen also that in the last few years, international collaborations have really skyrocketed. Today, there are very few scientific projects that are done by a single person. Groups of people work together, and we may have to start relying a little more on this kind of international and digital communications. By international, all I mean is that non-local interactions with people using devices like Zoom or whatever, you know, Teams or Skype or what have you. This could change the way in which we have mentoring and collaboration. So there is some positive in the kind of technologies that we do have. I think conferences and meetings, at least for a short while, are going to be out. We don't want to travel. It's not going to be possible for us to, you know, to convince ourselves that it's absolutely crucial. So I believe that many conferences are going to move online. We can't congregate in large meetings. Just at the time of the lockdown, I was supposed to have been at a meeting in Italy where, you know, there could have easily been 100 people, and now all these are going to be just forbidden. And the nature of conferences and meetings may well change. I noticed that the principal was complimenting the ARSD college for your organization of several webinars and so on. Maybe this is how we will all learn to communicate effectively in these times. You could also save a lot of time traveling, so that's a positive, I guess. This is the topic of research funding that I'm actually most concerned about. The post-COVID era is going to see India considerably poorer. Not just India, there's an economic downturn all across the world, and I believe that that's going to have a serious impact on research. As it is, funding for research is less than 1% of the GDP. But now the GDP is going to go down. And this is going to be lead to an overall reduction in research spending in India. This is the opposite of what we need. And although science administrators keep telling us that this is not going to happen, this is inevitable. When there is no money, how will research funding either stay at the level it has been and how will it increase? The arithmetic is it just doesn't add up. At the same time, we must realize that this is the time to boost public research, basic research. Now more than ever, we need to ramp up research in all areas of science, pure science, applied science, keeping in mind that the only insurance that we have for the country to face crises like this, or to even solve any of our own problems, is to have a very strong science base. And there is no option but for us to do this. So my concern is that research funding might go down, or rather that it almost surely will go down, and that the world economy, maybe there is a global recession coming, I don't know. This is one part of the post-COVID scenario that actually is a matter of great concern. Because we can be sure that there will be many crises for us. This crisis is a pandemic, so people are working all over the world to solve the problem for us. If the problem was just ours to solve, we do need a strong local scientific base. And that is something that can only be ensured through basic research and boosting that. Now, cynicism is not an option for us, all right? If anyone has seen a picture like this, and remember that this is the year 2020, we know that India needs to change. After this immediate phase of the pandemic passes, we cannot go back to the way things were. This virus has exposed several fault lines in the way in which we are doing things so far. But luckily, even the government realizes that only science can help India against the coronavirus. So it's only basic biology, good medical practice. But all this can only happen when all sections of society have access to education. Maybe this is the time for us to realize that serious reforms are required. We hit the reset button. Primary education and secondary education in our country requires such massive reform if we have to bring our country into the modern age and not have pictures like this, the next pandemic that will come around. Can we use technology to reach all sections of society? If cell phone and smartphone usage in our country expand, can internet access also be expanded? If so many teachers are moving on to Zoom and such like, can we reach out more? We don't have too many options. And so it looks that perhaps this kind of crisis is the impetus that our system needed. The costs are not that high. Now, the city of Wuhan, where it all started, has slowly come back to life, so to speak. Wuhan is returning to a post-COVID normalcy. But what is this post-COVID normalcy? Everybody is wearing masks. Everyone is having their temperatures checked all their time. All their smartphone apps are monitoring everything that they do. So the future is really, it's masked and it's very, very wary. It's a little scared. We need constant alertness, constant vigilance, because we cannot afford a second wave of this pandemic. Okay. I believe that by and large, when we come back, the future for us is also not going to look very different. We're going to have to keep eternal vigilance and eternal alertness and a complete change in the way in which our public spaces are fashioned. And we should be prepared for major changes as well. And with that, I'd like to conclude my presentation and I thank you for your attention.
Thank you, sir. Any questions? You can write in the box. Sir, there is a question from Dr. Manika Jain.
Yeah.
Thank you, sir, for sharing your wisdom on the topic. It was indeed insightful. My question is, how can online teaching learning be made inclusive, especially for the vulnerable and marginalized, and contextually relevant in India, which represents a highly diverse section of students?
Yeah, this is something that we are going to have to impress upon everybody that there are ways of doing it, which I'm sure that you might have thought a little about it. See, one of the problems that we do have is that a lot of our online access is urban. So we could now put up a lot of effort into seeing that the internet access all over the country has to improve considerably. Along with admitting students into classrooms or into universities or colleges or any kind, all right? One of the things that we could consider is giving them devices on which the internet would be accessible. So regardless of their personal financial capabilities, the institution could undertake to actually provide devices for all the students, because if this is the only way in which you're giving your classroom, your classes to students, it would make a lot of sense if, you know, this is a small additional cost. I mean, today a device comes for, you know, under some, you know, 20,000-30,000 rupees. So if a college admits a student, they also have this as part of the budget. I mean, this is one way. I'm sure there are other ways that people can think about. But one of the things that we have to immediately worry about is that we have to increase the internet access all across the country.
Thank you, sir. The next question is from Dr. Arvind Kumar. Thank you, sir, for sharing your views. My query is, what types of alternative we can adopt for subject having practical labs in this situation?
See, the practical labs is a major problem, and I don't see any way out but actually to have labs being carried out in shifts. You know, one of the options that we may have to explore is that we have fewer students in each laboratory, but we have constant monitoring and we just have to have many more sessions. This means more effort on the part of teachers and of lab supervisions and so on and so forth. But today, even in JNU, for example, what one notices in a physics lab, which is the only one that I have some experience of, is that there are two and three students who are together doing an experiment, and there are something like 30 students in a room. This is not going to be possible. So if you have to have this kind of social distancing, instead of one lab session, we're just going to have to extend it to four lab sessions or three lab sessions or what have you. And this may even be true for lectured classes. So, I mean, everyone is going to have to share some of this burden. And one of the burdens may be that you have to have more teaching. And especially for labs, I don't see any easy way out.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. Sir, there is another question related to labs only. How can we manage our lab after reopening of the college with 40 to 50 students in chemistry lab? This is from Dr. Bhagwati.
Dr. Bhagwati, I've just said, you know, I mean, the chemistry lab, physics lab, any lab requires, students. I mean, these are crucial parts of the learning. That's one of the things I said early on in this lecture was that each subject has a way of being taught. You may not need a lab for, some arts subject, but you do need them for the sciences. I don't see any immediate way out other than to require that we have different shifts and perhaps rethink the labs. You see, usually when we have so far devised a curriculum, we've said that a student must do 12 experiments in a semester or, some number. Maybe reduce that number, think a little more about the kind of experiments that need to be done, but then also see that every student has access and can do it, and therefore you might just have to do it many times.
Thank you, sir. Sir, this is another question by Vijay Kumar. How could we evaluate students on large scale in semester examinations? That means internally or practical exams.
There is no low effort answer, which it's there in my mind, okay? See, multiple choice questions which are given online is hardly the way in which most teachers like to have students answer their questions. So it may become necessary for us to administer written examinations in a way where, let me just say that there is no simple answer. And again, we are going to have to find out a solution for us. But I have a feeling that this is going to require more effort and more work on the part of the teachers. Namely, instead of just, I believe that going for a multiple choice option is not the right way to do these things. I'm sorry, I know that wasn't a very satisfactory answer. But I want to also point out, it's not as if one has all the answers. This is a scenario that's going to be evolving, and we are going to have to figure out how we cope with it. But we also know what is acceptable and what is not acceptable. Sending your questions by WhatsApp and getting your answers by email is a simply unacceptable mode of examining. So now that we know what is unacceptable, let us also try to figure out what is it that we'd be happy to live with.
Now, sir, the next question is from Sumanta Sahu. Thank you, Professor Ram Ramaswamy. Yesterday, I saw an article in scroll.in that said only nearly 8% of youth in India have computer systems with internet access. So how can online education be possible? Yeah. Facilitated?
Sumanta, I did actually point out that particular article in one of the slides that I presented.
Scroll.in,
and 8% have got access. This is true. My solution to it would be the point is not to say that since we don't have internet access all over the country and so on and so forth, so we stop everything. We can't. Where we do have internet access, we should try to see that every student has access. Namely, I had already made a suggestion that it becomes the responsibility of the institution to see that each student has a device on which they can access the internet. This is one not very expensive way of doing it. These devices are today not very expensive, and compared to the cost of education, it can be done. What is more important is also to see that the internet reaches the more rural parts of our country, and that could be one, you know, that could be one of the things that we really have to push for.
Thank you, sir. Sir, another question from Nidhi Sharma. While we have switched over to digital ways, we are also aware that arts are known for their humaneness. How do we make sure that the worth of human interaction is not usurped by digital spaces? Does technology not only intrude but also dehumanize education, especially in case of sports?
Especially in case of?
Sports, it's written.
No, I mean, it's reasonable. I mean, I find that the webinar has dehumanized a seminar. I would have really enjoyed having all, you know, the faces in front of me. But I realize also that I can have students who are sitting in Bombay or in Orissa or in, you know, Kanpur who have joined in this particular webinar, which they would not or could not have. I think that we are going to have to think about, or we're going to have to explore dual modes. That is to say, a given course may have a certain amount of the course that is given online, along with contact hours or interaction sessions where we can, you know, where we can maintain the required kind of distancing. Now, see, the point is that you cannot stress any one part of the system too much. Stay with me for a moment. Supposing we have a class of 100 students, which you break up into two batches of 50 each. A teacher can give some classes to both these sections, that is double their time and so on, so that you can maintain your social distancing and you can maintain all the required health. But it would also, you know, you can't double the load of the teacher. So I have a feeling that we are going to have to come to some mode where a few classes will have to be given in this physical mode, but a large number of the additional classes could be given digitally. I mean, this is just something that one is coming up with off the top of my head. As we see this experiment going on in future, namely that even when we come back, we cannot come back to what it was like last semester. The classroom is going to be very different. Already, universities in the United States have said that the remaining semester of the year, that is the so-called fall semester, is likely to be online in every university. From Harvard, Stanford, Princeton, they've all already said it's going to be online. They're not even sure about a year from now, that is the winter semester of next year, 2021. So this dual mode is something that we may have to explore. We are going to have to see, some of these things emerge as solutions that our system has to throw up. Again, you know, it's not as if I have, a perfect answer for how it should be. I'm only suggesting how it could be, and how it will be is going to be what I think our system is going to have to throw up.
Yes, sir, there is a question related to it. Will e-teaching have adverse effect on jobs?
Yes, absolutely. E-teaching has adverse effects on almost anything, except that it is better than no teaching. Right? Some of these responses are really in the light of what are the chances. You may not like Kerala very much, but if that is the only vegetable you're going to be able to get for the next few months, then you're going to have to learn different ways of making it. So if e-teaching is the only option that we have in a realistic manner of speaking, I think that it would be wiser for us to see what is the best we can do out of it. Teachers have noted that it's very bad for inequalities in the system. It has a poor amount of people who get onto MOOCs and to other kinds of e-courses have frequently given up. Namely, people don't stay very long with these kind of courses. But today we have very few options, so we may have to change that. The statements about e-teaching were when it was just one of the options of teaching. Now, when it is the primary option, we may have to learn to live with it and to do better by it.
Thanks a lot, sir. Now there is another question. How could we conduct online exams as connectivity is very poor in rural areas? Even in cities, sir, it's bad.
No, I agree, Vinita. Finally, it'll come down to this. Look, maybe there are other ways of doing things other than to have these exams where you've got 15 questions which have to be answered in 1 hour or 2 hours or what have you. Is there a way of figuring out whether the student has learned the subject without the same... See, the exam system is something that hasn't changed for 100 years. I did exams when I was a student. I gave exams when I was a teacher. My teachers took exams, gave exams. It's been the same way forever. Now, this outcome-based evaluation of courses actually asks us to think, what is the outcome that we want? And how are you sure that your teaching has achieved that? All I'm saying is that we as teachers also owe it to our own profession to think, how do we change evaluation? I agree that in today's day and age, online exam where a student has to give, 16 answers in 1 hour or what have you, that is going to be difficult with online connectivity. But is that the only way in which you are sure that the student has learned? Maybe there are other ways of trying to ensure that. It requires a lot of honesty on everybody's part. It's not as if, and worrying about students cheating or teachers cheating or whatever, all those are, points that I accept. But all I'm saying is that we have a chance to reimagine the future. Let's take that opportunity. The existing examination, when given online, is not going to work. So if you want to give your existing examination, perhaps we'll have to think of different ways of giving them. Hire out an auditorium for, where everyone can sit 4 seats away from each other and, write your proctored exam, as these are called. Something like that might have to be done. But certainly, the traditional examination given online is not an option.
You're right. You are right, sir. Now, there is another question from Naba Prakash. Thank you, sir, for the talk. Sir, I'm a research student. Accessing research articles and resources remotely is a necessity for research. What measures can be taken by institutions so that the process is facilitated?
Many institutions abroad and many in India, including the one where I work at nowadays, we have this virtual private networks, which allow registered, authorized users of the institution to access the internet from anywhere and have an environment which is virtually identical to their being in the institution. So as we speak, today, in when I'm sitting at my home in Hauskas, I can have access to all the journals that are subscribed by the IIT Delhi. Now, this is a responsibility of the institution. And every institution can do this without too much difficulty. It is just something that we have to do. And we are going to have to ensure that this happens in the post-COVID world. But it's very nice to know that Naba sitting in Orissa, if that's where you are, Naba, that you want your journal articles, good for you.
Sir, there is another question from Mr. Ajit Kumar. Sir, there are two Indias. One India is of those who have access to these ICT facilities, whereas in another India or the rural India, they are deprived of all these things. What would be your suggestions to assimilate these people?
These people are us.
Yes.
A generation ago, all of us were there. All right. So I think that we have to see that this is our responsibility. That is, by our, I mean those who have advantages and privileges. If we have this, I think it is only our, we've got to make sure that we are more aware of these two Indias. And we've got to ensure that we see that access goes out there as well. Instead of just leaving it as the responsibility of the central government or the state government, I do believe that each one of us with this sensitivity. If John Donne could say it 400 years ago, okay, no man is an island. So each one of us in India is connected to everybody else. This is at least one of the lessons that this kind of crisis teaches us, that we are all connected. It requires money, not too much. In one of my last slides, I've said that shouldn't we use technology to reach all sections of society and to be more inclusive? It's not just enough for us to do it from one side. We've got to make sure that it happens on the other side as well. And that with a little, as I've also pointed out over here, the additional costs are not that high if the will is there. And I believe that what I would like to see a little more of is the will.
Thank you, sir. Sir, there is another question from Sine Behera. Nice talk, sir. Can't we put the researchers on frontline to fight the pandemic with proper precautions? As you also mentioned, only science can change the situation now.
I've written about this also as it happens recently, that it's a real pity that in our society, all the scientists are largely sitting at home, because we have many identities. We are scientists, yes, but we are also humans. We are citizens of the country. We are parents, we are children, and so on and so forth. But this extreme lockdown has really removed a lot of scientific knowledge and scientific interaction at a time when it was absolutely essential. The bulk of our biologists don't have access to their labs. The bulk of our physicists and chemists don't have access to their labs and their discussions and so on and so forth. Of course, people can work at home, but it's inadequate, and we are all sort of unprepared for this. We really do need better funding and more facilities, and at least for the next time around, we need to be in a much better place. I don't think that we can all go to work wearing PPE suits. That's not going to be the way in which one can work. But this is a pity that the system doesn't have the the safeguards for this.
Thank you, sir. Sir, there is another question by Dr. Renu Agarwal. Sir, as we know, teacher acts as a role model for students. Please advise how emotional and behavioral part of teaching can be incorporated in online teaching.
This article in Nature recently talks a little about this. But these are all imagining scenarios where online teaching is augmented by a lot of telephone contact or what have you, guidelines for, not some suggested guidelines, this is also very Western. It says, don't convert your entire lecture to videos. And this is what Dr. Agarwal is pointing out. Students want to see a teacher's face or voice and hear the voice. Don't use only live conferencing for every aspect of the course, right? And invite student engagement and feedback. Check in with students often. Make students interact with one another. These are all, these are options when you don't have any other option, right? And the last point over here, identify and support struggling students. Every student has performance penalty. That is, you earn a lower grade in online course or they fail to complete courses. This is the most common thing. People say, oh, I started a Coursera course or, it's a khatam nahi kiya business, all right? So when you switch to remote learning, everybody performs much worse than they, not much worse, at least worse than they would in a regular class. So you need to keep engaged with the students. This requires more work on the teacher's part. More hours on the phone, more hours, on Skype. But like I've said too many times now, we don't have any other options. We still want to, you want to have your teaching done. You want to engage with the students. You can't afford to be close to them. You can't see them, but how do you, optimize all these things?
It's going to be a challenge, really.
Yeah, it is.
Instead of education.
Yeah. But, above all, cynicism is not an option. We have
to change. You are right, sir. Sir, there is a question from Dr. Nidhi Dureja. Sir, day before yesterday, DTU has announced the conduct of examination using artificial intelligence. She's giving a statement. So can it be done with other universities as well?
I'm not sure what, one is tempted to make bad jokes about artificial intelligence. I personally think that you have a chance to rethink how the process of examinations, right? Not for every course, not for every student, not all of, not everywhere, but I'm not sure what the DTU model is, right? Quite honestly, I don't know what this artificial intelligence way of conducting an exam is, but if it's successful, let's hear more about it. Whatever it is, I believe that we're going to have to come up with new solutions. It cannot just be, business as usual.
Right, sir. Sir, another question from Sine Behra. Nice talk, sir. Can't we put the research? Okay, this I have already. From Ruchi Sharma Pandey. Sir, this session has kind of opened several questions. We, the teachers, will definitely need to learn new ICT skills, but shouldn't the universities and institutions also provide some technological support so as to bridge the generation gap, as you mentioned?
Okay, so now my answer is really to Professor Jha. All right, so Professor Jha, this is a question you're going to have to answer on behalf of you're the leader of the institution. You are going to be facing this problem because it's not, you're not just going to be transmitting the rules of UGC or the Adesh उन्होंने बोल दिया है कि कीजिए तो करना है. It's not going to be like that. I think teachers are going to come to you and request for more resources. And I think that one of the main things that an administrator can do is to facilitate. May I request on behalf of all the teachers, not just of ARSD College, but of other colleges as well. Online teaching is not just the responsibility of the teacher. It is the responsibility of the institution. And as I've also said, it's the responsibility of the student. Where the institution comes in is that it provides the overall framework. As you are doing today, the college is providing a framework for a webinar. You have a functional IQAC system. But now perhaps you have to ramp up. You have to have special classes for teachers on online teaching. What is the support that you can give your teachers? What is the support that you can give them, on the technically, but also on the soft skills of online teaching? So on behalf of all the teachers of ARSD and other colleges, I'm requesting you, Professor Jhaar, do give a thought to this. He doesn't have to respond, Vinita, please. I think he understands what I'm trying.
It's a challenge for him also.
Of course, it's for all of us.
Yes.
Oh, sir, we are going to support our teacher and arrange all the facilities for the students also, whatever we can do in limited resources.
Absolutely. And also try to see that your resources are not so limited. Get whatever little funds have to be got, please just try to get them. Because if there is no option, then at least ensure that your teachers are enabled and your students are enabled.
In fact, we have done the training program also for the teachers, online training program for the online teaching. And still they should learn for the online teaching.
Nahin, hum sabko seekhna padega, Jha sahab.
Sir, there is a question from Dr. Battilal Bairwa. गिरती हुई आर्थिक स्थिति और देशकाल में हमारी सामाजिक प्रतिबद्धता क्या होगी?
फिर से कहिए.
गिरती हुई आर्थिक स्थिति और देशकाल में हमारी सामाजिक प्रतिबद्धता क्या होगी?
I more or less understand it, but it's also say hello to Battilal. देखिए, I did point out that one of the biggest negatives of the COVID is going to be that the economy is just gone for a six. Our GDP is going to go down fairly considerably this year. And with a reduced GDP, our priorities will have to change. We will not be able to spend, public spending in various different aspects is going to come down. Now, given this, I am actually concerned. I've phrased the concern in terms of support for basic research, but I do worry that the economy's failure is going to have serious ramifications on all other aspects of our social life. At least for, in the very short term, it's going to be pretty bad. Now, it's going to take a lot of management to bring it back to something which is acceptable. The concern that I was articulating here was for research. And research funding, but Battilal is, it's correct to point out in other aspects as well. I think the social consequences are going to be pretty severe. I know it's not an answer, Battilal, but this is to acknowledge that there are other dimensions other than just education and research where the economic downturn is going to play a role.
Thank you, sir. Sir, there is Another question from Mr. Sheesh Kumar. My question is, Professor Ramaswamy, does online education and employment negatively affect in social and personal relationships? Is online education a permanent solution for students? Does it facilitate students to read, and will the results be good for its students? Sheesh Kumar from Kalandi College.
Sheesh, I see my opinion of online education, I've already made it quite clear. I don't think that this is the way for us, you know, in the, this is not an ideal situation. However, given the fact that this disease is going to be with us for at least a year, 2 years, something like that, before we can get back to normal, and even that normal that we will get back to will be a caricature of what we are used to. Until that, you know, for that duration, we are going to have to figure out other ways of evaluating each other, other ways of engaging with each other, and other ways of testing, for want of a better word. All right. So I would say that we see this as a temporary phase that we go through, but we can also learn that one has to be able to take some positive out of it. If you don't have an option, what do you do? So e-learning, when there was the option, we felt that e-learning was not as good. When there is no option, I believe that we can come up with good ways of implementing e-learning.
All questions are actually interlinked. Sir, there is a question by Mr. Vijay Kumar. Can we use Indian Postal Service for exam evaluation? Should we take the next question then?
Yeah, sure. No, I mean, it's like this WhatsApp university.
Yeah, yes.
My thing is that, you know, why are you so hung up on exams?
Yes, teaching is more important.
Teaching and try to figure out some other way ki, you know, samajh mein aaya ki nahi.
Sir, we'll take the last question now by Prishika Raj. Should government make a norm for online classes? Sir, what is your opinion?
See, education is the samajik problem hai. It is not a governmental problem. The less that government has to do with education, I believe we will be much, much better off. See, finally, who are we educating people for? We are educating for our society, for our communities. We are educating for us. If we ask the government to have a norm, they will come up with a norm which does not recognize the difference between Kashmir or Kanyakumari. It will not recognize the difference between internet access in Arunachal Pradesh versus internet access in Gujarat. I mean, the government, because it has to apply to everybody, it will not be in a position to give something which is actually practical for us. My sincere suggestion is that governments should have very little to do with it. Let societies come up with the way in which we want to educate ourselves.
Sir, so we'll end it now. Sir, as you rightly said, a lot of brainstorming is needed, and it will be a great challenge for education post-COVID. Thanks a lot, sir, for the fruitful discussion we have had. And thank you, sir, for this informative, enlightening, and insightful session. And hopefully, all of us will be able to make the most of it. Thank you, sir, for your valuable time.
Thank you very much for having me, Dr. Vinita and Jha Sahib. Thanks a lot for being hosting me.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir.
My pleasure.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Okay.
Dhanyavaad, sir.